Greetings all, Ferrariman601 here. Before we say anything else here, I just want to say that there are some people out there who take things way too seriously. Look at the big picture, guys. We are only on this planet for a finite amount of time. And quite thankfully, most of us have no idea for exactly how long that amount of time is going to be. However, we're here and we're alive for far too short a time for us to be preoccupied with getting into the weeds of nitty-gritty specifics and literal interpretations and getting ourselves obsessed with the finite infinitesimal details of every last potential aspect of every last obscure subject. It doesn't matter that much. Go outside, go take a walk, go observe the beautiful sunny day that maybe you've got outside, or go outside and enjoy the sound of the rain. Whatever it might be, get yourself away from your computer screen for a little bit and just take in the grandeur that is the greater world beyond. Of course, I'm getting into all of this philosophical nonsense because of the latest video from Autosport. Yes, the very illustrious, very prestigious, and typically very reputable motorsport news outlet who apparently have taken it upon themselves to lambaste Jeremy Clarkson on a video that he put out a few days ago talking about the current state of Formula One. In this video, Autosport, they proceeded to go line by line, point by point, eviscerating Jeremy Clarkson. The first point that they seemed to have the biggest contention with was Clarkson's idea of getting rid of the stewards because they are too draconian, they impose too many penalties, and that the fans want to see dangerous driving. On the face of it, yeah, of course, this is an absolutely ridiculous proposal on the part of Jeremy Clarkson, but I want all of you to think about this for a moment. Who is Jeremy Clarkson? How has he made the vast majority of his career? Yes, of course, he is an automotive journalist. And in the past, you can go and you can find columns that he has written and you can find TV spots that he has done in the old Top Gear days coming from the early 90s, wherein he did review sensible everyday cars in a sensible everyday manner. But by and large, late 90s, early 2000s, mid 2000s Top Gear is where Jeremy Clarkson really cemented himself as a household name. And how did he do that? He's brash, he's boisterous, he is a bit of an idiot at times. And that's why we all absolutely adore his work. Yes, he is somebody who will go and create an electric car for Top Gear and call it Jeff, for instance. He is somebody who will take, I forget what it was, I think it was the Gumpert Apollo or whatever, and he drove it in circles until he threw up. Yeah, just demonstrating the ludicrous amount of grip that it had. That's what Jeremy Clarkson does. That is who he is. It's how he created his own personal brand, and it's why he has had TV contracts for decades, because that draws in the viewers. Of course, rational sensibilities that all of us have, Mr. Clarkson included, obviously you can't get rid of the stewards. And I wouldn't say that he's truly advocating for that. Again, take it in the context of who he is and the sort of brand and image that he has created for himself. The people do not want to see dangerous driving in a literal sense. However, people do want to see drivers taking calculated risks. They want to see side-by-side action. They want to see dive bomb, last minute on the brakes, overtaking maneuvers. It's racing, after all. We want to see drivers fighting for position because that's what happens in motor racing. That's all Clarkson's trying to say there. Again, stop taking things so literally. The next major point that I'd like to address. Clarkson, he talked about Gilles Villeneuve and René Arnoux at Dijon in 79 having that absolutely fantastic scrap towards the end of the Grand Prix, talking about that this should be the standard by which modern Formula One is judged. Again, going back to the previous point, people want to see wheel-to-wheel action. They want to see the drivers taking risks and then reaping the rewards thereof. Autosport responds to this by saying that it's a bad, lazy argument. What this is, again, you're taking his comments literally here. Jeremy Clarkson is not literally saying that every Formula One race should be Dijon 1979. What he's talking about is there needs to be more facility, more possibility for that sort of action to occur, meaning the cars need to be lighter. They need to perhaps have a bit more fuel on board. They perhaps don't need to be as efficient as they are because all of these things prevent the drivers from having these sorts of battles toward the end of the Grand Prix because they're either fuel saving or they're saving tires or the teams have told them to back off to save the engine. Things like this. And Autosport, in attacking Clarkson like this, I find it to be condescending toward any long-standing fan of Formula One because they're coming from the standpoint of the idea that because it's 2019, we cannot, as a matter of principle, look at the past and have any sort of opinion of it other than it's the past and it's gone and we must move on because it's literally the current year. That is completely asinine. Just because it is whatever the current year is, it does not mean that what we do today is better necessarily. It doesn't mean that what we do today is right and what we did then was wrong. There's absolutely nothing wrong with going back into history and looking at things from an objective standpoint and saying, okay, this is what happened here at this place and in this time. Did it work? How do we know that it worked? Or did it not work? How do we know that it did not work? Just because it's the current year doesn't mean that it's that we can't look back at history and say anything about it other than it's terrible. No, that is a very myopic mindset, and in my opinion, it's quite an arrogant mindset as well. I find it to be condescending and dismissive of long-standing fans because there are many people who have watched Formula One and other forms of motorsport for decades. Somebody like me, even though I'm only in my 20s, I've watched Formula One for what comes out to be about 53% of my life. So, okay, I've got a bit of a knowledge base at this point, and of course I know a lot about the sport's history, and I look back at the past and I look at some things that were a bit strange and perhaps didn't work so well, talking about things like 2005 and the tire rules then. But then again, I also look at things like the 80s and teams had qualifying engines. That's a cool thing. It really added to the spectacle in terms of Ayrton Senna, those pole laps that still get replayed at every award ceremony anywhere. That allowed that to happen. Maybe that was cool. You allow the drivers to push the cars. You allow the drivers to push themselves and see what they really can do. So, all right, maybe that's a good idea. Maybe that worked. Would it work today? Different argument. But it's very dismissive and very condescending to say any sort of argument that is grounded in something which happened previously is wrong. The next point, building off of the previous two, Clarkson then says, I don't want to watch Formula One anymore. Formula E has better racing. Well, objectively, it does. If you want to see wheel-to-wheel action, if you want to see drivers making overtakes consistently throughout the entire length of a race, you see that in Formula E. Almost constantly. Now, of course, Autosport goes into the nitty-gritty immediately, taking everything literally, saying, well, Formula E cars have less downforce, and they have a fixed amount of power that they can use during the race, and they have fan boost, and they have the attack zones, and all of this. It's like, you missed the point. Again, Autosport. Formula E has better racing, yes, because it is a spec series, absolutely. But at the same time, what are the kinds of circuits that Formula E runs on? They run on street circuits, temporary street circuits. And I'm not saying that that's what needs to happen in Formula One. We have street circuits in Formula One already, and the results are a little bit mixed. But Formula E races in places that allow the drivers to attack. They're encouraged to overtake. They're encouraged to follow closely because it's very slow corners, very tight circuits. It bunches the cars together, so they're able to do things like this. Perhaps a redesign of some circuits is in order for Formula One. We know that the cars can't follow closely through high-speed corners. So why do we have so many circuits that have super long, drawn-out high-speed corners? We know it strings the field out. Okay, maybe we could take a page from Formula E. It works for them. Would it work for Formula One? Again, it's a mixed bag. We go to places like Azerbaijan, Baku. We go to places like Russia, Sochi. And we don't see great racing all the time in these places. We have had some eventful races in these places, but some of that has been down to the track. Some of that has been down to the complexion of the race, safety cars, incidents, whatever. The point is, just because something is not Formula One doesn't mean it's wrong. At the end of all of this, Autosport, they close their video out by saying, watch the races first, then come back with more detailed, proper debate. This, in my humble opinion, is arrogance. It is sheer arrogance. What Autosport say in this single statement is basically, if you are a critic of Formula One, you are uneducated regarding Formula One. If you don't like Formula One, you must not be watching it. Again, going back to the Dijon 79 argument, basically they're dismissing anybody. Doesn't matter if you're new, doesn't matter if you've been watching for a year or two, doesn't matter if you've been watching for decades, as undoubtedly people like Jeremy Clarkson have done. How are we supposed to have debate in an informed, proper, detailed manner as they are advocating for, if you're going to dismiss any dissenting opinion simply by casting the aspersion in the general direction of anybody who says Formula One needs X, Y, and Z? Well, clearly, if you think that, you don't watch it, you don't know what you're talking about. I'm not entirely sure what Autosport were doing here by, in my opinion, wasting their time having this response to Jeremy Clarkson, who, quite honestly, was doing this for a bit of a hyperbolic joking effect anyway, because that's simply what Jeremy Clarkson does. It's, again, the whole brand and the whole image that he has built his career off of. But what they've really done is they've shown their true colors by saying, oh, yeah, our opinion is the only one that actually matters, and if you don't spout our own opinions back to us in the comment section, then clearly you're uneducated, you don't know what you're doing, you don't know what you're talking about, you clearly don't even watch Formula One. Really, you need to just go away. Whether or not that was their intent out and out when they decided to make this little 9-minute feature, but that's what they did. That was the message that I came away with, and reading the comments under their video, which of course I'm linking to in my description, you'll see that there are quite a few comments who are saying something a little bit similar to what I'm asserting here. And really, not only was it a waste of their time, but I believe that they've really put their credibility out on the line as objective journalists. Journalists, first of all, you're supposed to be reporting what is actually happening. There are plenty of stories to talk about. The German Grand Prix is coming up this weekend. We had a tour bus run into the start lights earlier on today. That's a little bit of a story that you might want to talk about. I haven't heard about, are they going to be able to replace them in time for a free practice one? I would assume so, but I don't know. That's a story Autosport could have talked about. Mercedes unveiled a new livery this weekend to commemorate 125 years in motorsport. Or in automotive production in general, they invented the car as we know it. But still, they haven't talked about that. They haven't talked about the aero updates, the technical updates up and down the grid. No, they're talking about Jeremy Clarkson, who is, once again, speaking in hyperbolic terms because that is who Jeremy Clarkson is. It is how he has made his fame and fortune. So, be that as it may, those are my thoughts on Autosport. And again, to tie all of this back to the beginning, chill out. I want everybody to just chill out a little bit. You can't take everything you see literally. And not only that, but you can't take everything you see at face value either. Remember, we're living in the age of interconnectedness. We're living in the age of pretty much instantaneous communication. I'm recording this at 4:30 in the afternoon, and it'll be within the click reach of over 5,000 people by 7:30 in the evening. So that's pretty fast communication. What that means is there's not a whole lot of time to be vetting your information. There is not a whole lot of time available to confirm your source materials. And again, we're living in the era of fake news. This, in my opinion, is a bunch of fake news from Autosport. So again, chill out, take a walk, go enjoy the sunshine, and just relax a little bit. Don't take everything so seriously. Again, life is only so long. Until next time, thank you all very much for listening. Ferrari Man 601 saying thank you. And of course, we will see you soon.